Salam. I represent the fantastic people of Ede North, Ede South, Egbedore, Ejibo Federal Constituency of Osun State. Mr. Speaker, let me also take a cue from a few of those who have spoken earlier, and take a cue also from the guidance you provided to my leader, Honorable Osai Osai, that while looking at a document like this, we should not be fixated only on the low side, and that we should rather start from those things that we can say are worthy of being applauded. And the first one, Mr. Speaker, that I want to talk about has to do with the timeliness of this budget, which a few of my colleagues also have spoken about, especially yesterday, so that in keeping with the commitment we made to Nigerians to return the budget cycle to January to December, we have a timely presentation of this document. And I noted in the President's speech, especially on paragraph 3, that he said that this budget was prepared in a collaborative manner. I was just joking with my friend, Deputy Chairman, House Committee on Finance, that that collaboration must have been with his committee and the Committee on Appropriation, because in my own committee, most of the committees I'm not sure we were able to make any input into the preparation of the budget. But that's just by the way. Mr. Speaker, sir, the other thing I also want to just pick out has to do with the issue of the releases. Even though, you know, an appropriation act is a law, and a law is not to be observed in a certain percentage of compliance, it is also heartwarming that for the first time in a very long time, we are able to achieve capital releases of up to 50 to 75% in the 2020 Appropriation Act, which I also think is another very good point. And then finally, Mr. Speaker, on the good side of it is the need for us to appreciate the President. Maybe on behalf of Nigerian teachers, I'm a teacher also and an education entrepreneur, especially for the commitment that the President has made to improving on the welfare of teachers in terms of their remuneration and incentive to those who have chosen to go and study education in our tertiary institutions. I am so gladdened by this fact, and I want to commend the President, and I want to really hope that this will not just be a promise, not just be a commitment, but to be something that will be done, you know, timelessly also. Having said that, Mr. Speaker, whenever I pick a document like this, I look at it especially from those issues that I consider as the most important issues in our cause, in our quest for development as a nation. And to me, Mr. Speaker, the most important issue today in Nigeria, again, to buttress the point earlier spoken about by Honorable Wudil, the chairman of the committee on NDE, is the need for us to work seriously on job creation. Mr. Speaker, unemployment has become a very, very big challenge and threat, not only to security, but also to our democracy. Unemployment has become one issue that has limited the capacity of Nigeria to rise up to the status of its contemporaries. And Mr. President did say in this budget speech that he reiterated the point he made earlier on the plan by government to lift 10 million Nigerians out of poverty in 10 years. By 100 million in 10 years. By implication, we are talking about 10 million every year. And when you look at a document like this, Mr. Speaker, you will ask yourself, what is it in this budget that portends the possibility of lifting 10 million Nigerians out of poverty in the year 2021? Now, we all know that one of the spending that helps in the creation of jobs is the spending we do on our capital component of the budget. Mr. Speaker, I recall that in the year 2016, we had a 30% allocation for capital project. 2017, we had 30.7. 2018, we had 30.8. 2019, we had 30%. Last year, we had 24%. This year, Mr. Speaker, the budget proposal before us is targeting to spend 29% on capital project. I recall, Mr. Speaker, that your good self have a bill before this House, which I'm sure has passed through the second reading, seeking to compare that at least 50% of our annual budget, between 40 and 50% of our annual budget, is spent on capital projects. This is more so in view of the fact that most of these years we fund our budget through borrowing. We are borrowing over 4 trillion naira to fund this budget this year. And there is nothing that shows me here that we're going to be able to create 2 million jobs, because for every million naira that you spend on capital project, you create at least 50 jobs. Mr. Speaker, it is very, very important for us to get our attention focused on how we're going to drive our development to this very, very important sector of the economy. Now, the Minister of Works, like my colleague said earlier, is allocated 440 billion naira in this year's budget. Now, we have quite a number of ongoing works, ongoing road projects. Some have been on for the past 5, 6, 7, 8 years. In my federal constituency, as I speak, Mr. Speaker, there's an ongoing project on Akoda, Okegada, or Fatedo Road. There's an ongoing project on Oshogbe, Deawo, Iwo Road. And there is one that is meant to be executed beginning from the next year, which is the Awo Ejigbo, Oyo State Boundary Road. If we do not increase allocation to the Ministry of Works in a manner that will make sure that these projects are completed on time, we will suffer two things. Number one, these projects are likely to cost us more in subsequent years. And number two, the quest for us to be able to increase, you know, activities of workmen, of artisans, of electricians, of plumbers, and other categories of Nigerians on this road will be grossly limited. Now, the President spoke about the 774,000, you know, public works program, taking off this month. Now, as good as that project is as a palliative, it does not solve the problem of unemployment. It does not also solve the problem of skills acquisition, which the President alluded to here, because there is nothing in that program that seeks to empower these beneficiaries to acquire relevant skills within the time of when the project, you know, is going to last, which is just about 3 months. And then, Mr. Speaker, this is a time when we are talking about the need for us to cut down on the cost of government. And I can see something here in paragraph 59 of Mr. President's speech that, you know, there are additional 50 government-owned enterprises, and overhead provision has been made for newly created agencies. Now, I think we should take this very serious. Whenever you talk about cutting down the cost of governance, the attention of Nigerians is on the National Assembly. Yes, we may need to do certain things about this structure, but the more fundamental ones are the duplication of agencies of government that we have everywhere. And every year we budget money for them on capital and overhead and personnel, and yet we are still creating new agencies. I want to think that it is high time for us, both the executive and legislature, to collaborate together on what we are going to do to bring down the cost of governance in Nigeria and spend much more of our money on human capital development and physical projects in critical areas of our economy. If we're able to do that, I'm sure we'll be able to solve the problems of unemployment and consequently also address the problems of insecurity and a few other problems affecting us as a country. Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker, for the opportunity to make my views known.